Hi everyone and welcome to a new video about current sources using BJTs. This is our example number 4. In this example we will discuss the Widlar current source that is used specifically to create low currents around the microamps. And we will see that step by step in the calculations, also verify these in SPICE simulations. So let's look at our circuit. This is the Widlar current source configuration. You see again those two transistors in the simple current mirror which I've discussed. But now we have this resistor here extra, which will then create that Widlar effect. We have one DC source, VCC, and we have again the R1 here that creates this reference current. Remember the VBE1 and VBE2 now are not exactly equal to each other, so there's a difference, and that difference makes this Widlar current source or create this low current. So what we need, let's see what is given first. The VCC is 8 volts, that's actually here. VBE1 is set to 0.7 or assumed to be 0.7. The Q1 and Q2 are matched, that means they have the same physical dimensions, the emitter areas, the beta, and also the early voltage are exact same. In this case, it's infinite. Now we would like a design for the load current IC2 of 5 microamps, so quite low. And we need to use here a reference current of 100 microamps here. So that is given. So let's see what we can do in order to design this load current. Now, the first calculation before we move on, let's designate the nodes here. We have two nodes, X and Y. And we use then the Kirchhoff's current law, KCL at node X. Now we know that IRF here will split in IC1 and in this current, but that current is also again splitting at node Y in IB1 and IB2. So you can write that then directly as IRF is equal to IC1 plus IB1 plus IB2. So IRF is then the summation of these three currents. Let's designate as equation number 1. Now let's also develop the Kirchhoff's voltage law from top to the ground. We have this loop here, which is VBE1 is equal to VBE2 plus the voltage across the RE. That's shown here. And this emitter current of the second transistor is here given as IE2. Now let's designate also this equation number 2. We know that IC1 is related by this exponential expression, which is then the saturation current, which is dependent on the physical dimensions, the temperature, a lot of parameters. And then times e to the power the VBE1 over the thermal voltage, which is approximately 26 millivolts at room temperature, let's say 27 degrees. So this is, by the way, also an approximation. The exact expression is a little bit complicated, but this will do the job for most cases. In a similar form, you have also for IC2, which is this collector current. And then you'll see again this saturation current times the e to the power this fraction here in the exponent. So we can express now the base emitter voltage here like so. So you can have now the IC1 over IS1 and then take the ln of that one and then express this in this format. And you can also do that for the VBE2. Now we can now use this equation number 3 and equation number 4 in this equation number 2. We can now substitute that and we get now this expression. Now when we place this to the left side, so this first term on the right hand side, you get this expression. Now when you now see this expression here, you can now take this VT out and also use the identity of ln of a quantity minus the ln of another quantity. That will give you the ln of this first quantity divided by the second quantity, which is shown here. Now that is a nice result because we said the Q1 and Q2 are matched, so they are equal to each other in the physical dimensions, etc. So that means IS1 and also IS2 are exactly equal to each other. Then we have that these will be divided out. You only have the IC1 and IC2 as our fraction here in the ln. The right hand side is still the RE times the emitter current of this Q2. Now let's designate this equation number 5. Now we can rewrite equation number 1, the first one as shown. We have IRF is equal to IC1 and the IB1 is of course IC1 over beta and IB2 is IC2 over beta. Now we can now take these two terms together and then also replace this third term to the left side. You have this equation. Now you end up actually by multiplying the left and the right hand side by beta, you get this expression. Why we do this? Because we would like to have an expression which will relate this IC2 to IRF. So I need to get rid of this IC2. We have now this expression. Now when you move on, you can now divide by the beta plus 1 as a factor here. So you get now this expression. Now you have an expression for IC1 in terms of RRF and also IC2 and also the betas. Now that equation number 6 can now be substituted in equation number 5. We have now this expression, which is not that complicated, but this is a more exact expression. We have now this, and when you now want to use this in exact form and also want to directly go to the IC2, you need to also rewrite this emitter current, which is actually beta plus 1 over beta times the collector current. Then you have the full exact expression, of course, assuming this approximation here before. You have also an approximate expression for this that can be used if you want to find your solution faster. This is now this expression. This is the approximate expression of this exact expression. Now, what is happening here? Now, this beta plus 1 over beta is normally very close to 1 because beta is large, let's say 100 or maybe 200. So this is 1, so it is actually unity. So that's why you have RE times IC2 here in the right hand side. The beta times IRF is normally much, much larger than this IC2. So you can say this is dominating. And in the denominator, you have beta plus 1 times IC2. This beta over this beta plus 1 is also approximately 1. So you get actually IRF over IC2 here in this expression. Now you can now solve this and then find your required parameters. Or you can use this and you get the more exact value. Well, we'll see both of them. So let's collect them here. Okay. Moving on, now looking at the exact values, an exact expression, this is our exact formula. Now substitute everything we have given here. We have the beta 100 and also the reference current and also the load, which is required. And also our thermal voltage, which is 26 millivolts, approximately, of course, at the room temperature and the rest. And we get now here by solving the RE, 15,370 ohms. Okay, we now also look at the Kirchhoff's voltage law because we also want to calculate the R1 because we now did only RE. You can use this expression and express the R1 in terms of the other parameters. Now you can already do that here and you get now 73 kilo ohms. The approximate expression is using this formula that goes like this, and then you can now substitute all the values here that goes actually in a similar form, and you get now close to that one but a little bit larger. You get now 15,578 ohms. Now again, a similar form here for the Kirchhoff's voltage. That doesn't change, by the way, because this part, left side of this equation or the circuit, is the same for the exact and also for the approximate. So you get also 73 kilo ohms. So we are now done. We can now collect the solutions here for the exact and also for the approximate analysis. Let's look out at the simulation result. This is the exact simulation results. And this is from the approximate, so because the R1 is still the same, but only changes the RE here. You see that the change here. If you look at the exact solution or exact simulation results, you see that this IC2 is 4.966 microamps, and this is 4.916 microamps. So the approximate, actually the exact analysis or solutions for the exact simulation result are closer to 5 microamps. The difference between the exact and the approximate here is approximately 0.05 microamps, so let's say 50 nanoamps. So we better go for the exact analysis as shown here. Of course, we need to tune this because we need to have this 5 microamps. Of course, in the practical sense, this is perfectly fine. No one really bothers about that. And there is also another thing I didn't mention here, because the IRF here was actually 100 microamps. And we have here 101.584 microamps. So that is larger. Maybe that is not available. So also this needs to be tuned to 100 microamps. So there's a tuning procedure really required. So this is the tuned circuit. You can see the R1 and also the RE has changed. But how do we do that? There is a tuning procedure of a BJT Widlar current. So this is the tuning procedure I use, not that I have found somewhere else. This is just what I think is logical. So I want to share with this with you. The first step is actually adjust one resistor at a time. So that's always the case actually in general. In this case, I adjust only R1 in order to get that required reference current. So in order to lower this 101.584 to 100 microamps, I need to increase this. Now I did that, and at some point I ended up to 74.16 kilo ohms. So in order to get the available current for the reference current. Now, and then step two is, since this is done, I can now focus on the RE independently and then say adjust on the value of the RE here and, until I get this 5 microamps here. Now, what do I do? Of course, I need to lower this because I have a smaller value for the current, so I need to lower that in order to increase this. So then R1 has changed, as said, from 73 kilo ohms to 74.16 kilo ohms, and RE has changed from 15.370 kilo ohms to 15.50 kilo ohms. And now this circuit will do the job for this design. Okay, let's also look at the load voltage versus load current using these two tuned resistor values. Of course, this is now the circuit. It has changed a little bit because this VCC is not connected now to these both nodes. It's only connected to R1. And this node here is connected to VL, which will be varied. And then we will look at the effect of this IC2. That's shown here. You see here the load voltage, and this is the load current. And this is the load current here, starting from 5.0004 microamps all the way to 5.0005 microamps. So these steps are very small. And you can see actually a very small slope here. It's almost constant looking at the scale here. So you can say this is a perfectly fine and almost constant current source. Again, as said, in order to create a very low current, like 5 microamps, maybe lower, you need to create here a really large resistor if you just use a simple current mirror without this RE. That is really the basic idea or the advantage of the Widlar current source. So this will now do the job, and also we have seen that the load voltage versus load current variations are very small. All right, this is our example about the Widlar current source. We have discussed the effect of the load voltage variations and also discussed how we can tune the parameters, resistor values for our design in order to get that load current which is required. If you have any questions, comments about this example, please let me know. I will try to answer them as soon as possible. See you next time in another video. Take care.